most complete athletic footwear store. Where else you gonna go? In by Nutrin, big pain relief in a little yellow pill. The Lighthouse has served as a maritime reference at Nobsco Point on the southwest tip of Cape Cod since 1828. That same lighthouse has marked the one-mile reference point for the last 16 years for the thousands of runners traversing seven of the most famous miles in the world of running, miles which constitute the Falmouth Road Race. Hi, everybody. I'm Tony Revis, along with Alberto Salazar in Woods Hole, Massachusetts, on a very windy and humid day for the 17th running of the Falmouth Road Race. Alberto, you set the course record back in 1982. It still stands. The question is, why they bring in top fields every year?
Well, Tony, I used to point for this race. I would go to Europe and run on the track circuit during the summer. I'd run 5 and 10,000 meter races. Then I'd come back home and I'd give myself about 2 weeks of rest from racing. And then I'd point for this race and I knew that I was ready because I was very sharp from those track races. Now a lot of these runners aren't pointing as much for this race as I used to do.
On the women's side of the competition, we have three or four women who have won in recent weeks. Very well-matched field. Let's go down to the street right now and check out the top competitors, both on the men's and the women's side. There's our defending champion, Mark Kerp of Missouri, and his stress fracture in March, not expected to contend today. 1987 Falmouth women's winner, Aurora Cunha of Portugal. Here's Washington's Lisa Weidenbach. A lot of experts have picked her to be the women's favorite. Newly ponytailed Rob DiCostello of Australia, third here in 85. There's Anna Audane on the left, and defending champion Ann Hannum, both of New Zealand, going over the rolling first 3 miles on the course. And on the left, Kiwi master Kevin Ryan loosening up with New York City Marathon champion Steve Jones of Wales, the men's favorite today. 6,300 official starters, and some 3,000 so-called crashers in the race today. The race has started in front of the Captain Kidd restaurant ever since its inception. Alberto, it's quaint, but it can also be dangerous.
Well, right now, these runners' nerves are stretched to the breaking point. Because of the narrowness of the street, they're very scared of being tripped up at the start.
Co-directors Rick Sherman on the left, John Carroll on the right, make sure everything is in order for the start. The gun is up.
It's a mad dash for the first half mile here as the runners try and establish a good position out of Woods Hole. It's very important to get out in front so that you can have good, clean running space in all the turns.
Falmouth 1989. We'll have the action right after this. Along with Alberto Salazar. Alberto, sort of a sneaky weather day, sort of hot and sort of humid.
Falmouth has always been known as a hot and humid race, but today is probably one of the most favorable races that I've ever seen.
Now up front, Rob DiCostello from Australia, one of the great marathoners in history. This looks like his form of old 1986 Boston Marathon, where he ran essentially a time trial to the course record.
Rob really loves uphill, so it doesn't surprise me that he's pressing on this uphill portion of the race. You know, in a short while, they'll be taking a sharp right-hand turn. After that, the road gets really windy.
Right with him, in second place, Brian Charette from Zimbabwe, running really well this summer. Marcus Barreto from Mexico, rounding more into top form. In the blue, Silvio Salazar, an early leader last year, but he faded to 15th place. He's from Colombia, racing well in South America on the track. So there's really a Latin influence early on in this race, and again, we've come to expect that throughout the last couple of years in the world of road running.
Speaking of Mexican distance runners, probably a big encouragement to those runners here today is the fact that 1986 winner Arturo Barrios just recently set a world record for 10,000 meters on the track.
Falmouth continues to be the most lucrative of the non-marathon road races in the country. On the far outside, Marcus Barreto had his tonsils out after starting off hot in 1989. It's taken some time to get back into top form.
Marcus
says that it's been very hard for him because he's always liked to compete for first place. He's just had to let time go by and wait for his body to regain its strength.
Alberto, this is the first place on the course where they're running out in the open, right along the water. 20-mile-an-hour winds out there today, but where is it coming from?
This morning, I ran along this exact portion of the race and found that fortunately for the runners, it's mostly a tailwind.
Here's our first look at the leaders on the women's side. All our favorites right in a row. F2, Aurora Cunha from Portugal, winner in 1987. Margaret Gross, the Olympic Trials marathon champion from the United States, winner last week in Asbury Park. Judy St. Hilaire right there as well, but we're moving up past that pack of favorites. That's Joan Nesbitt, winner in 1984, a surprise leader at this stage. Knobsville Lighthouse. That means they're at mile one with Deke still in the lead.
First mile, around 4:28, and that's almost exactly what I ran in 1981 and 1982 when I won, setting records here.
With Di Castella doing the leading, Alberto, he's such a seasoned veteran, everyone's comfortable with him doing the work.
I always think of this race as having three stages. First mile, it's a mad scramble to establish position. The next 2 miles, we're back in the woods, back in the roller coaster hills, where you just try and conserve energy and save as much as possible for the third stage when you get to the flat out in the open.
Last year, the Americans swept the top places on the men's side as a lot of the foreigners were getting ready for the Olympics in Seoul. Now, as we make our way up through the leaders, we don't see an American anywhere in this top 10.
A lot of up and downhills here, but they're not much factors because they're so short.
But what may be a factor, a lot of runners are nervous about the footing out there. A lot of ruts, a lot of potholes. Martin Pitayo on the left has joined a four-man pack. Marcus Bredo in the Reebok colors, he's right in the middle of the street. Number 20, the white bottom and the blue top just turned around. He's from Italy, Salvatore Bettiol, second. Gone out of the picture altogether, and the only true marathoner up there is Bettiol, the leader.
He's here with his coach, who also coaches Olympic champion Domingo Bordin and two-time New York City Marathon champion Orlando Pizzolatto.
Even when Marcus Barreto was coming back from his tonsillectomy, he led races like the Atlanta Peachtree Road Race in July and last week's Asbury Park 10K until the time that he couldn't stay up there. He's not used to having anyone pace that in front of him. Now we look at the women's competitors between the 1 and 2 mile mark. The first mile went by in 4 minutes and 54 seconds, the fastest first mile split in Falmouth women's history. Now it's F2, Aurora Cunha taking over from Joan Nesbitt, who's just over her left shoulder, along with Anne Audet from New Zealand, a 34-year-old four-time Olympian. The second mile in 4:58, two sub-5-minute miles on a day like this, extraordinary for the women. Judy St. Hilaire with the ponytail, also in that lead pack. The only top woman not there that we expected, Lisa Weidenbach.
And there in the Harvard shirt is my old friend, Ron Lafreniere, who I used to stay with when I ran the races here. He's a physician here at this point in the race, always here with ice-cold sponges, which provide instant relief on a hot day like this.
We have a mini break on the men's side. Barreto and Bettiol have opened some ground on the rest of the pack, which is pretty well strung out as well. Alberto, it's early in the race. These are like the old Shorter Rogers duel, which broke up around the 3 mile mark. In recent years, we've expected the race to go all the way past the 5 mile mark in 1985, all the way to the wire.
Usually right around here, getting close to the 3 mile point, up to the 5 mile point, where the real racing starts.
This year, the racing has started a little bit earlier, as now Bettiol pushes the pace even more. As a marathoner, does he have to do this? He probably doesn't have the kick.
He probably has the experience, though. The thing about a marathon runner is that they're usually used to running a hard pace on their own from up in front. So if Bettiol's up and up this early, pushing the pace the whole way, he's probably feeling confident about how good he feels.
Ryan Cherie from Zimbabwe has rejoined that group. And Alberto, he really does look smooth. Maybe he's just been evening out Bettiol's moves.
Out of the three, he probably looks the easiest. He's hardly swinging his arms, whereas you see Barreto really uses a lot of arm action, whereas Bettiol is somewhere in between the two of them.
And just when we thought it was breaking up into a two-man race, here comes Rob Di Castella back into the action. We spoke to him about his condition before the race.
At the moment, I'm just getting back into what I consider to be good shape. I had quite a long break after the Olympics, and it's taken me a while to get myself fit again. So these races and training that I'm having now are really just building up for the Commonwealth Games early next year. My performance and fitness has been improving every week, and I'm happy with the progress. But, I'd just like to not let any other marathon runner like, Steve Jones beat me today.
Interesting, Alberto, at the Peachtree Road Race, Rob was 15th place at the Big 7 in Davenport, Iowa, 10th place, so he's moving up the ladder, but this is somewhat of a shock. Here we have our three women's leaders, Cunha in the middle in the blue. On the left with a very high arm action, Judy St. Hilaire. She lives just up the block in Hingham, Massachusetts, and Anne Audet from New Zealand. She spoke with Judy before the race. Literally.
I respect this course a lot more because of the first three miles.
Yeah.
The toughest part, I think, and it can set you up for a tough one if you go out too hard. So, I mean, you really can't go out conservative either because the field is real tough. So, whatever everyone can do today, I'm going to try to key off the other runners. But, I really can't predict how I'm going to run right now.
Three still together in the women's competition, but Cunha has been the controller throughout. four men together bet the Ultim Italy. Been the main man ever since the get-go. Alberto, they're on the flat section of the course in the open. What goes through a racer's mind right now?
This is usually the point where the eventual winner or winners are going to start to break away. Because right now, there aren't any more distractions in terms of hills or sharp turns. Right now, it's just a matter of who's got the ability to take the most pain, who's got the ability to press it.
Every time Bettiol turns around, he drops another contender. Looks like Barreto was on the ledge that time. Wonder why Falmouth is known as the Great American Road Race? And as illustrious a list of multiple winners as any race in the nation.
You can see right here, the runners are out in the hottest portion of the course. They're right out in the middle there. There's no cover whatsoever.
The form of Salvador Garcia, sergeant in the Mexican Army. He moved his way very gently through those first 3 miles and has now assumed the lead as they pass 4 miles. His last race, a 107 half marathon in Puerto Rico 3 weeks ago. Sort of a slow time, but it was very hilly and very hot and humid. Seemingly excellent preparation for Falmouth. Before the competition, we asked him who he would key on today and about his chances. This athlete profile brought to you by Newport.
Espero echarle a todo a fondo hasta lo máximo para
Salvador said
ganar
he's going to compete against everyone all the way to the finish.
Pues
and with a little luck, he thinks he can win it.
Road race. I'm Tony Revis, being joined by our course record holder, Alberto Salazar, and we're deep into the competition at this point. As we look at our three female leaders, from right to left, Aurora Cunha from Portugal, Anne Audain from New Zealand, living in Boise, Idaho, and Judy St. Hilaire, who lives on the south shore of Boston, Hingham, Massachusetts. Alberto, which one looks best?
Aurora Cunha really looks like she's in control. Her form hasn't really changed at all throughout the entire race.
The other two have taken water, and Cunha has disdained it. She lives in Lisbon, Portugal, along the ocean. It's hot and humid. These are probably conditions she's used to.
A 7 mile race really isn't that bad under these conditions if you're trained for it and you're prepared for it. She obviously is.
At this point, St. Hilaire looks like she's through for the day. Garcia and Bettiol with Di Castella fading in third. Alberto, they're coming to the end of Surf Drive. They're turning onto Shore Street. This is where you won the race back in 1981. Is it a significant part, or does that happenstance that you happen to win it there?
With 2 miles left to go in the race, usually somebody's going to try and show all their cards at this point. I think that Garcia right now is going to try and make a move.
One thing we know for certain, these men have never raced against one another. Garcia is a 2:10:47 marathoner, Bettiol 2:11:41. Hard to compare since they were on different courses. One was a victory, Garcia at the New Jersey Waterfront this year. Bettiol, second place in New York City, 1988, 3 minutes behind Steve Jones. This looks like a significant move. Alberto, you talk about showing your cards. We thought it was Garcia. Are we seeing the whole card being turned to Bettiol?
He's pulling an old trick here, picking it up when he goes for the water rather than slowing down to competition expect.
He seemed to check where Di Castella was in third before he made the move past Garcia, decided Deke was not a threat. That's when he moved. Based on the splits we've seen so far, Alberto, your course record? Seems tight.
They're about 20 to 25 seconds behind at this point, so unless they really pick it up a lot, it's probably out of reach.
Joan Benoit Samuelson, who is here in Falmouth with her baby Abigail, she's 4 months pregnant, has dominated the women's competition here, winning 6 times. A lot of heavy rains in the last couple of weeks in the Northeast. We can see how green the Cape is. It's usually a little bit more brown. And the woman we didn't see throughout the entire race has now moved into third place, Lisa Weisbach, Issaquah, Washington. She set American records at 15 kilometers and 10 miles so far in 1989. You wonder why we didn't see her earlier and why now she's coming from behind, Alberto. Maybe she's playing it as hard as we thought Garcia was.
With 3 miles left to go in the race, there's still a lot that can happen in the women's race.
She's known as much more of a heavy pace setter. She hasn't raced in a month. Maybe she wasn't nearly as race sharp as Cunha had been coming from the European track circuit.
Here we can see Bettiol's legs. It's not what you usually envision most distance runners as having in terms of long, spindly legs. He's got very thick, squat legs.
No wonder he runs the marathon. No wonder he cramped up so badly at New York City last year. But Garcia still very much in the hunt. The gap has opened up, but it's not opened up a lot. Although, is Garcia turning over a lot or loping along a little bit? I mean, he's tired.
Garcia definitely looks better, but without a doubt, he's falling back. Just goes to tell you that looks don't mean a thing in running.
What does Garcia have to do, Alberto? At this particular state, he's still within mental contact, even though he's calling off physical contact. You can see how boring ahead his eyes are. He's still in it in his own eyes.
He's only 15 to 20 yards behind. As long as he doesn't let that stretch to 50 or 60 yards, he'll still have the ability to reel him back in.
And now, Judy St. Hilaire has been passed by Lisa Weidenbach, and she set her sights on second place, Anne Audain. All along, we've been talking about contact being absolutely necessary to ensure victory. And yet, here is Lisa Weidenbach moving her way through the field. Alberto, is there a significant difference, you think, between men's running and women's running at this stage?
The difference is in the men's race. Once the runner falls back from the leader, there's usually not anyone there for him to run with. Whereas in a woman's race, she always has other males up there that she can run with, she can use to help try and get back into the competition.
Or to push her along, as we see with Aurora Cunha and the two men that she's got by her side. She takes a quick glance back, doesn't see anybody. The man in the electric green shorts in the back is about 2 seconds behind her and about 5 seconds in front of her chaser. We can see that Cunha is much closer to record pace than the men are, as Garcia still looks strong in second place. He's got himself back together. The question is, how far is the gap up to Vecchio?
At this point, that gap's starting to lengthen out to about 30 meters. It's going to be harder and harder for him to maintain that contact.
Vecchio's head's down. We don't see him race that often, so it's hard to tell whether this is a normal sign for him or he's really starting to show fatigue.
He's been looking back a lot throughout the entire race. I think that's a sign of weakness sometimes. It shows nervousness. Sometimes it'll spur the other runners on behind you. They'll think that you're tired, and that's why you're looking back.
This is brought to you by Runner's World Magazine. Looking along Surf Drive, Alberto, when you ran in this race, you were up in the front. When I ran in this race, this is where I was. I'm telling you, it's a lot uglier back there. We're looking at Salvador Garcia from Mexico. When last we left him in second place. Based on the fact that we're moving up fast, we must be going up to Vecchio. You mentioned letting get 70 or 80 meters, and the race is over. We've got less than a half mile left to go. Vecchio doesn't look good, but he looks like he's going to win.
At this point in the race, unless Vecchio completely falls apart on that last major uphill, which is always a possibility, I don't think that there's any way that Garcia's going to catch him.
Last year, the Falmouth Road Race began a sister race relationship with a race in Boiano, Italy. Fitting that we now have an Italian victory. Victory not assured in the women's competition yet, though. Lisa Weidenbach moves past Judy St. Hilaire and Anne Audain. She's hoping to move just one more spot up to Aurora Cunha. But she's got her work cut out for her, Alberto. But she's really struggling, and look how nice Cunha looks.
Cunha looks fantastic. She's like a machine. Her form hasn't changed at all in the first 100 meters of the race. I doubt it's going to change now with only a mile to go.
28-year-old Salvatore Vecchio of Italy, seventh and second in his previous American road races at the New York City Marathon, now gets to experience victory and at one of the grand finishing stretches in all of racing.
There's nothing like coming down that last downhill with all those people cheering you on.
Salvatore Vecchio, 1989 Falmouth Road Race champion. And in second, Garcia barely holding off Di Castello. This is Steve Spence from Boulder, Colorado, in fifth place, the first American, and Dick and Rick Hoyt in their 10th Falmouth Road Race, followed by Leonardo Reyes of Mexico.